way. So, but on the 16th at 11 o'clock, Dean Clarence Matthews, we will honor his life, his legacy, what he meant to us, and what he meant to this church. I'm calling all of you that are able to please come on the 16th. Deacon Matthew, as I put on Facebook, is one of the sweetest souls I've ever met in my life. Very gentle man. He served this church as a usher. He served as a trustee. He served as a deacon. He served as the church treasurer. And you know, I've come to learn that even when this building was being built, there was some financial struggles. He would write a check to make sure that things got done, you know. And you know, he was just all. Matthews would help anybody. He would help anybody, and loved everybody. And so it is only fitting that whether you knew him or not, you come out and honor his memory. He was our second oldest serving deacon. Deacon Sykes was the first. He passed in 2013, in December 2013. Deacon Matthews was our second, who just recently passed. So please come out and let's honor his life and his legacy, if you all please don't mind. Ushers, I need you here. Deacons, I need you here. Trustees, I need you here. Ministers, I need you here. I need as many choir members as possible. And I'll talk to a couple of you individually about what the family is requesting regarding his homegoing celebration. This afternoon, the body of Sister Mabel Smith will lie in state at the arena on 71st and Calumet from 3 until 9 p.m. With the exception of a few of you, you probably have no idea who she is, but it's all right. She's part of our faith family. And she made her transition, I believe, last week, week before last. We just found out about it last week, but they're having graveside services tomorrow at Oakwood Cemetery, but the body will lie in state on tonight from 3 until 9 p.m. So let's keep that family in our prayers. And as I shared with my officers and praise and worship team, before I go, I can say it now. You know, if you have not heard that, if you're a sports fan, Brother Stuart Scott passed this morning. Stuart Scott was a commentator for ESPN. He was a good brother, good brother. He finally lost his fight to cancer. But as I told him, he's 49 years old. I told him he may have lost the fight, but he won the battle. He won the victory. He got the victory because Stuart was a saved brother. He really was a saved brother. He understood his salvation, where his salvation came from. And so we keep them in our prayers. Also, Sister Zara Johnson, Brother Hank Johnson, Sister Zara, they sit right there midsection. He called brother the other day to let me know that her brother made her transition down to Louisiana. And so they were traveling down there on yesterday. So we want to keep Sister Zara family in our prayers as well. The Lord is still calling folks home. The Lord is still calling folks home. But there's a joy in that. And the joy is, at least for those of us that have accepted Jesus Christ, we got a home to go to. Say amen to God. But I am going to say this. I'm glad to be alive. Talk to me, somebody. Are you happy to be alive? No, I'm glad to be alive. Whenever I'm training young preachers, I tell them all the time, I say, you know what the best part of a funeral is? I said, when you can walk in and walk out. Amen. I'm happy to be alive. Yeah, so keep all of that in those persons in your prayers. Keep all the announcements. Oh, and on the 16th, as it relates to the service with Deacon Matthews, I need persons to volunteer to serve. We're going to have lunch next door after the memorial service, and then we're going to Oakwood, where the family has chosen the place to urn next to his wife. But we're going to go next door. So I need some of you that will serve. I have taken the liberty, because I don't like doing stuff without letting you know. I have taken the liberty, I call it pastoral privilege, of letting the officers know that the church will underwrite the repast, that we're going to underwrite it, as opposed to, you know, trying to get folks to cook here and all of that. No, Deacon Matthew deserved for the church to be able to underwrite this repast. That's the least we can do. Reason I'm letting you know, because I don't want nobody coming to me when your family member passed talking about, well, y'all did it for Deacon Matthews. Well, there's a reason why we're doing it for Deacon Matthews. All right? So we all clear. All hearts and minds are clear. We don't have the food gated in, and I need for us to be there to serve the family. All right? Say amen, somebody. Is that all right, Brother Deacons? Brother Chairman Emeritus? Is that all right? Brother Treasurer, is that all right? All right, well, as long as I got their permission, we all right, we good to go. All right, we're good back with streaming yet? We're up and running. Those of you that are watching this by way of stream, let me just say we apologize for the technical difficulties, but it's the new year, you know, so maybe it was 2K. Year 2K got us in 2015. But come on, let's say amen for our streaming community. God bless you. And welcome back. If you're visiting with us for the first time, please stand. I see you back there. I see you, my brother. Man, I like the lot. My night. Are you a first time visiting? My brother. You've been there before. You look familiar. We might be kinfolks, maybe. Kinfolks. I see y'all back there. It's good to see you. We want you to know that we are excited to have you here. Faith Family of West Point Baptist Church, where we're living to serve God by serving humanity. We count it not robbery that you would decide to come and worship with us, especially on the first Sunday of the new year. And we want you to know how much we appreciate your coming out to worship with us now. Because you're here, we want you to feel comfortable worshiping in the manner which is most comfortable for you. If you want to run, run. If you want to cry, cry. Clap your hands. Go ahead and clap your hands. Just know that we are excited to have you here. We don't call you visitors. We call you family we've never met before. And we want you to know that also at the selected time of worship service, when the invitation to Christian discipleship is extended, when we say the doors of the church are open, we invite you to come and be a part of our faith family. If you already have a place to call home, go back and tell your pastor, say, you know what, I wasn't dipping today. I was worshiping at the greatest church this side of heaven, Faith Family at West Point Baptist Church, located at 3566-72 South County. Go after it. Well, I serve as the proud pastor of these fine folks over here. And we want you to know, my brother, my sister, my brother, my brothers, my sisters, that the Jesus in us loves the Jesus in you. West Point, let us stand. Love on them, love on each other. Love on Jesus in me. any musicians, before the choir comes to us, I want to make sure a couple of things. Where are my young brother? My babies. Where are my babies? Okay, here's what I need. Because there is a section in the sermonic moment that I am very sensitive about what children hear. I need that once the sermonic moment begins, matter of fact, during altar prayer, after altar prayer, take the young babies downstairs for me. Pastor Lee, you can stay up here, but I need you all to take the young babies downstairs. So if you're 13 and older, I can roll with you. 12 and younger, I need you downstairs. Okay? Again, pastor is very sensitive about what young people hear. And there are certain things I don't feel like I should say, parents should be saying to them. All right? So please have them go downstairs. Also, we're happy to have Brother Andre back with us. Brother Andre, he was out of the country for an entire month. You know, he is our cardio praise and worship member. Always, that boy loved him some Lord. All right, and all of you that were traveling all month, happy to see you back. Brother Jordan, Brother Eric, happy to see you all back. All right, come on in. Everybody, rest on your feet, rest on your feet, rest on your feet. How many of you know that the Lord has been blessing you? Elder Hillman, I need you to come up here. Now, open that door. Come on. How many of you know that the Lord has been blessing you? Now, if you don't know it, you'll know it by the time this is over. I want you to put those hands together. Come on and join the choir and say, every time I turn around, you keep on blessing. Yeah. have any blessed folks in the house? Don't sit down. Do you have any blessed folks in the house? Alright, well this is where you look at your neighbor and tell them, I'm one of them blessed folks. I'm one of those blessed folks. Come on and bless the Lord with the fruit of your hands. Tell them I'm blessed. We're gonna shift the order of worship for a moment because I want to read the scripture lesson. I want us to read the scripture lesson together. All night, all day. Because it's prayer time, but I want to. Bulletin, but you will see them on the screen. From 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 3 through 12, and chapter 5, verses 12 through 23. From the New International Version. And I want us to read together out loud. I want you to read it out loud. Starting with verse 3. Let us read together. It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. Keep reading. Such sins as we told you and warned you before. For God did not call us to be impure, but to live a holy life. This is the reader.
Therefore,
does not reject the human being, but God, the very God who gives you his Holy Spirit. Verse 9. Now about your love for one another, we do not need to write to you. You yourselves have been taught by God to love each other. And in fact, you do love all of God's family throughout Macedonia. Yet we urge you, brothers and sisters, to do so more and more, and to make it your ambition to lead a quiet life. Now wait a minute, I want y'all to read this. Read. You should mind your own business and work with your hands, just as we told you. Keep reading. So that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders, and so that you will not be dependent on anybody. Go to chapter 5, verses 12 through 23. Let us read. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love. Because of their work, live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Keep reading. Encourage the disheartened. Help the weak. Be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Keep reading. Rejoice always. What else? What else?
Give thanks in all circumstances.
Why?
For this is God's will
for you. Keep reading.
Yes.
Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul and mind be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. It's prayer time. I invite all of you to join me at the altar. As you come down, I want you to join us. And why we are here in 2015 is because all night, all day, singing with us. Join us down here at the altar. Join us down here at the altar. Let me hear you singing. All night. become saying that we're much obliged for this opportunity and this privilege to be able to call upon your name here in 2015. We thank you, oh God, that you've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. We thank you, oh God, that your grace and your mercy does not operate on chronos. Because if it did, oh God, we do realize that it wouldn't have transferred into 2015. But because your word tells us that your mercies are new every day, we stop here to say thank you, oh God, for fresh grace and fresh mercies. We thank you, oh God, for the gift of your Son, Jesus the Christ, who died so that we may have a right to the tree of life. And then I stand here, oh God, thanking you for these your people that you have allowed me to serve as their pastor. My prayer is that you will continue to be with them, guide them, lead them, and strengthen them as you did from January 1 to December 31. I know that you will, oh God, for every day that you allow us to see the dawning of a new day. And now, oh God, I'd be remiss not to ask your blessings upon them. And for those that are not here, for those that can't even pray for themselves, my prayer is that, oh God, that your Holy Spirit will rest upon them and let them know we stand here intervening on their behalf. We pray, Father, for the sick, the shut-in, for the bereaved, and the distressed. We pray, oh God, for those who are outside of the walls of the local church, not only in this community, but abroad. We pray, oh God, for our brothers and sisters in third world countries. We pray, oh God, for every preacher that will stand on today, declaring the acceptable year of the Lord. Give them preaching power. Let your people know what's on your mind through the preacher. For you said, oh God, how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? And so allow your preacher, oh God, to hear from you. And then, oh God, for these that are here, that are standing at the altar, who are remaining in their seat, have your way with them, oh God. Have your way in their lives. Control their destinies, oh God. Give them the strength that they need in order to fulfill their life's calling and their life's purpose. And then, oh God, we be careful not to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for every day that you allow us. It is in Jesus' name we do pray. And all the saints of God said amen. All the saints of God said amen again. Come on and say it like you mean it. Put those hands together and bless the Lord. Hug your neighbor and tell them, I love you in Jesus' name, and you go back to your seats. usually when it's good to her, she was like, okay, glory. She was like, okay. And she still ain't glory. Because there are times when that should happen, but there are times when your pastor just needs to sit up here and just teach you. First Thessalonians, chapter 4, verses 3 through 12, chapter 5, 12 through 23. And I want you to keep your bulletins open, keep your Bibles open. Because you're going to need to follow along with me. And because it is my practice to put a subject to the sermon, I want to talk about don't waste the gift of a new year. Don't waste the gift of a new year. My question that I want to pose to you is, have you ever stopped and asked yourself why God allowed you to enter into 2015? Seriously. Out of all of the celebrations that have taken place, and we were here New Year's Eve, and we talked about the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. shall preserve thee, the Lord shall preserve thy soul, the Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. We talked about that, and I'm sure at midnight a lot of people are excited because you made it into a new year and things of that nature. But have you ever, ever stopped and asked yourself why God allowed you to make it into 2015? And I'm serious about that, especially with everything that happened in 2014, whether you witnessed it or not. And that includes God dispatching angels around you so you couldn't see the potential harm. Because I need for somebody to understand that just because you didn't see it didn't mean it was not plotted for your demise. When we sing all night, all day, the angels keep watch over you. The angel was warding some things off that was created to kill you. So even if you did not see it, it seems that the question should arise of why did God allow you to be here? And then watch this. While he didn't allow others to be here, what's so special about you? Why didn't cancer kill you in 2014? Why didn't you lose your mind in 2014? Why did God allow you to be here in 2015? Who would have imagined that 2014 would result as the end year for someone you never thought wouldn't be here today, because their death in 2014 was so unexpected? What was God thinking about by leaving you here but taking others away? And although I cannot answer this question of why God allowed you to be here for 4 days already, I can offer for you that your entering into this year is a gift from God. It's a gift. If there were some honest folks in here today, you would testify by waving your hands that based upon what happened in 2014, you really shouldn't be here. Just wave your hands and I just talk to you. Yeah, based upon stuff that folks saw and what folks didn't see, you know yourself that you shouldn't be here in 2014. And watch this, I'm not talking about a physical death either. Somebody in here shouldn't be here mentally. Shouldn't be here mentally. With what you endured in 2014, if I can just be honest with you, you really would have been justified in throwing in the proverbial towel. Since you're here, and I know you're here because I see you. Since you're here, and it's only because of God's gift of grace, I submit for your consideration that you really take time to examine why God has, for however old you are, allowed you to witness the beginning of yet another new year. You ever think about that? For however old you are, that's how many new years you've seen. And there's got to be something to it. There's got to be something to it. God has gifted you with another year for the purpose of doing something. God didn't gift you with another year for the sake of you just existing. And I'm using the word existing to mean being around but not functioning. Just existing. Because the world is full of people who are choosing to just exist. And they're existing without tapping into why God has them here, has them not fulfilling God's purpose. And for every moment that God allows them to remain on his earth, He's giving these existing people another chance to find their purpose and meaning. If you have not figured out what your purpose and meaning is, and the Lord continues to allow you to wake up, He's giving you chance after chance after chance to discover what it is that He wants you to do. And not just to exist. And this is why I raise the question of, if you've ever stopped and asked yourself why God allowed you to enter into 2015, outside of God's gift of Jesus the Christ to save us, the gift of a new year is a gift of grace. And I want you to watch this, because it comes with an opportunity to do and be what God wants us to be. Let me say that again. The gift of a new year is a gift of grace that comes with an opportunity for all of us to do and be what God wants us to be. I like to call it, if you don't mind, a divine gift of do-over. Divine gift of do-over. Whatever you did or didn't do in 2014, by virtue of your being here today, and that includes those of you that are watching my streaming, you get another opportunity to start over in a totally new year. So you think about it this way. There's a chance you'll get a totally new birthday in 2015. If it's the Lord's will. There's a chance you'll get an opportunity to lose the weight you resolved you was going to lose in 2014. So all of a sudden everybody's showing teeth now. Y'all ripped and things of that nature. There's a chance you'll get an opportunity to save the money you said you'd save in 2014. But it didn't quite happen. There's a chance you'll get an opportunity to find new love. Or rekindle old love. Or get rid of. Somebody said, "Boo, be gone in 2015. I get a new chance to get rid of you in 2015. It's the divine gift. I call it the divine gift of a do-over. So with the y'all laughing kind of hard over there, but y'all got some booze y'all trying to get rid of. Here it is. It's the divine gift of a do-over. But if you don't stop for a moment, my family, and appreciate God's gift while asking this very important question, what shall I do with this gift of a new year? God gave you the gift of a new year. What should I do with it? If you don't stop to do that, it calls into question whether you take God's gift of a new year for granted. And as I always remind you, people don't have to be nice to you. I'd also rest upon your spiritual conscience that God doesn't have to allow you to be here. And because life and death is in God's control, this really should speak to your understanding that since He's allowed you to live, since God spared your life so you can continue living, the question I beg of you that should arise from every aspect of your total being is the question that is asked in Psalm 116, verse 12. What shall I render unto God for all His benefits toward me? What is it? What should I be doing since I'm here 4 days in? And the answer, my friend, is very simple. Live to please God. Live to please God. Now let me set this up for you. Because I did not say live to please Elder Nard James. I said live to please God. Not live to please your neighbor, not live to please your spouse, but to live to please God. And gang, let me just reiterate, I cannot speak to the specificity of why God has gifted you with this new year. I can't. I can, however, speak on behalf of God and what God wants from you. Don't miss this. That what God wants from you, from here, all the way around this worship center, present company is included, not excluded. Even the children downstairs. What God wants from you in this new year is for you to be purposeful and unwaveringly committed in living to please Him. We spend so much time trying to live to please other folks. And what's so interesting is that at the blink of an eye, the other folks we're trying to please may not even like us tomorrow. Matter of fact, I heard the Lord, they don't even like you today. They're just acting like they like you because you're doing something for them. But the minute you stop doing for them, they'll show you exactly what they think about you. God desires for all of us this new year. That's why He had you come here today. That's why you braved through the snow. I'm sure that some of you came because you know I'm going to start the new year off right. I'm going to start in church. That's what I'm going to do. Because I said I was going to do it last year, and I kind of fell off. And I'm going to start again this year because God gave me the gift of a divine doer. So that way I'm going to start church off right. I'm going to brave the weather because I'm going to put on my boots because I'm going to make my way there. Well, let me just say, the reason why God has you here is because He needed, He wanted you to hear what He has to say. The reason why you logged on screen because it wasn't working earlier was the reason why the Lord fixed it, because He wants you to hear what He has to say. He wants you to know what it is that He wants out of your life. All this other stuff about, oh, this is your breakthrough year and God is going to do this and God is going to do that. What are you going to do for God? To that trap of this God give me business. God has allowed you to live 4 days already into a new year because He wants something from you. Again, He wants you to purposefully and unwaveringly commit to living to please Him. Our guiding principle for 2015 and beyond, if beyond is in the Lord's will, is for every parishioner of this local branch of Zion to be. And it is over my right shoulder, but I will read it because some of you cannot see it clearly. It says, and this is our guiding principle, to be an intentional disciple of Jesus Christ, growing in Christian discipleship by making Jesus priority. Following Jesus' teachings and sharing Jesus with others. An effective disciple of Jesus Christ lives to please God in all they do. And it's because an effective disciple of Jesus Christ understands the power of the gift of grace that God gives to us through His Son, Jesus the Christ. And if you love, let me take the inventory. How many of you love the Lord? How many of you not sure? All right, if you're not sure, all right. If you love the Lord as you proclaim, it shouldn't be difficult not to waste your gift of the new year by not living to please God. And let it not be said that I didn't tell you that if you reside that living to please God is not on your agenda, then you really have taken God's gift and thrown it back in His face. But for those who truly want your 2015 and God to be different than it was in times past, God has offered His word to us today on how He desires us to live. So, okay, preacher, I get it. You know, God wants us to live for him. That's good. But how does that happen? All right. And God offers it. He offers this instruction through the pen of Paul in his first epistle or first letter to the church at Thessalonica. So when we're talking about 1 Thessalonians, you know, he's writing to the church at Thessalonica. Now, if there were no other time, you take notes. I plead to your spirit man or spirit woman that you take notes now. If you don't take notes any other time you're here, take them now. Take these notes now. You're on your bulletin. You can write it on the back of your bulletin. It says the main points of the message, the application of the messenger. If you put it in your smartphones, or if you got tablets, or whatever the case may be. But I really, really implore you to take these notes. So that way, these notes will guide you, or rather they'll serve as a rubric by which to measure your progress or success throughout the year. My prayer is that you didn't just come here to sit and say you fulfill the obligation that you came to church, that you actually want to hear what God has to say and you want to put into practice what it is that the Lord wants you to do. And so I want you, if you don't mind, take your notes so that way you can look over it next month and see how well you've been doing. Now, or go back, and if you got questions, you're like, Pastor, I got a question. I need to shoot you an email, or let me call you because I'm not clear about X, Y, and Z. Are we together? All right. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 3 through 12. In chapter 5, verses 12 through 23. God speaks through the pen of Pastor Paul as he writes to the church on how to live to please God until the day the Lord returns. Now, for those of you that are not familiar with what that means, one day the Lord is coming back. If you don't believe anything, you believe that. He is going to come back. But there is a way we should be living until his imminent return. And this is good information for us today because it speaks to how we, as practicing Christians, should always be ready. Don't miss this. We should always be ready for Christ's return. We should always be ready. We don't know when the Lord is coming back. Now, we got some context clues about how he's going to come back. But we don't know when he's coming back because it says he's coming like a thief in the night. We don't know when he's coming back. But we know he's coming. All right? So, it's good practice. We don't want to be caught in an uncompromising position when the Lord returns. Now, let me challenge you. Think about where you were New Year's Eve. Or think about where you were New Year's Day. Or think about where you were on Friday. Think about where you were on yesterday. And answer this question, because I can't answer it. If the Lord would have come back at that very moment, where would he have caught you? I wish y'all could see the look on some of y'all faces. I ain't gonna pass judgment. I just simply ask a question. Where would he have caught you? Huh? And my point in saying that and asking that question, the point of that question is that we should always be very cognizant that the Lord can come at any given moment, which really should help guide what we do, where we go, and what we say. Y'all with me? The Lord. We don't want to be caught in an uncompromising position. It's why we practice. Now, if there's someone here on the sound of my voice that you are new to the faith or you're trying to figure this whole thing out, let me just say you something. You know, you may hear people talk about Christians. We call ourselves practicing Christians. And the reason why we call ourselves practicing Christians is because we practice, which means we don't get it right all the time. Somebody should say amen right there. We don't get it right all the time. Sometimes we get it right, and sometimes we don't get it right. Now, mind you, I am, and I need you to understand this. For those that know, you know. For those that don't know, you don't know. I'm about to tell you now. I am going to always be honest with you. And in my honesty, I'd say that practice doesn't make perfect. Practice makes better. It makes better. I don't stand here. I see that I have the purple robe and the kente stole and the tie, bearing the cross, and things of that nature. But I don't stand here as one who has arrived on all these points I'm about to give.
All right.
I'm not going to stand here and lie to you. I practice like you practice. Because I'm on this journey with you. Pastor doesn't mean perfect. Talk to me, somebody. No. We're on this journey together. I practice living to please God daily. And if you're looking like, oh, I can't believe you just said that, not a pastor. Well, then guess what? Pastor Paul, who actually wrote it, who God spoke to write it, he had to practice living to please God just like I had to practice living to please God. Paul was the one that said, every time I want to do good, evil is always ever present. I don't think so. Well, what wicked man am I? He struggled with it. You follow what I'm saying? So I don't want you to think that I stand here. No. The best sermons are the ones lived. Talk to me. But now, I am going to offer this. When you're too stubborn to even put living to please God in practice, Paul writes that you don't know God. Yes. So even for the person that is sitting there right now and you call yourself tuning me out, you ain't tuning me out, you're tuning the Lord out. But I am going to warn you, because if you tune the Lord out on that great day of judgment, because he will come back and he is going to judge. There is no standing there saying, well, I didn't know. Because I'm going to tell you, I'm going to absolve myself of all of it because I'm going to tell you. And if I'm standing there with you, I'm like, Lord, I told them, and they went to sleep. They started texting. They nodded, and I told them. Matter of fact, go to the streaming, go back to the recording one. That is right there. See what I told you? Tell your neighbor, say, wake up. Hearing. Tell your neighbor, no excuses. Don't be stubborn. It's going to hurt. But guess what? We'll be all right. Y'all ready? You ready? All right. Let's examine how not to waste the gift of a new year by living to please God all year. Here's number one, which is in chapter 4, 3 through 5. Live to please God by committing to control God's body by controlling yourself.
All right.
Let me say it again. Live to please God by committing to control God's body by controlling yourself. Matter of fact, Miss Erica, baby girl, yes. Go to your PowerPoint. You can move the thing off the screen and just type the points up there as I've said so that they can have it, okay? All right. Live to please God by committing to control God's body by controlling yourself. Now, this is gonna throw somebody off. This is chapter 4, verses 3 through 5. Stick with me. God desires for each of us to be set apart. That word sanctified, to be sanctified. It's nothing more than God does not desire for us to be like everybody else. We're not supposed to be like everybody else. We're not supposed to. And the reason why I ask for the babies to go downstairs is because this right here talks about sex. And so now maybe you understand why I want the babies to go downstairs, because I don't think it's my place that they need to hear the word that they may have heard it before, but I don't want them hearing it from me.
Let that be the responsibility of their parents and guardians, so that way they ask them. No, let's have, come on, grown folks, God talk. The world glorifies sexual sin. I'll say it again, Eric, so you can get it. Living to please God living to please God by committing to control God's body by controlling yourself. And then in parentheses put chapter 4. Now just put the 4, number 4. 3-5. All right, so that's that right there. So you're gonna take that first number. And let me go back again. The world glorifies sexual sin. And the reason why, I notice everywhere you look now, it's about sex. Sex sells. You look at television now. Now, I watch Scandal. I watch How to Get Away with Murder. And you can rest assured that Shonda Rhimes is going to always put something in there about sex. I don't care if it's man with woman, woman with woman, man with man. I don't care who it's with, because sex sells. Outside the Bible, what do you think the number one selling magazine is? Playboy. Because sex sells. The pornography industry makes millions and millions of dollars. Don't get uncomfortable. I'm in the book. It sells. Now let me just say this. Because there's nothing wrong with sex, because God created sex. There's nothing wrong with it. God created it. But here's the problem. The problem is when you allow sex to guide and dictate your life, and don't miss this, with those with whom you're not supposed to have sex with. Y'all ain't used to this type of talking in here. Huh? I'm in the book. Sexual immorality is illicit. It's illegal. It's prohibited sex. And yes, it includes pornography. And for those who want to challenge, because I'm sure some of you want to challenge it, please understand that the word Paul uses in writing is the Greek word porneia. P-O-R-N-E-I-A. He uses that word porneia, which is where we get our English word pornography. So living to please God calls for you to consciously work on not serving your own physical self-appetite and sexual sin, but to control yourself, because your body is God's body. Your body is God's body. And for those of you that don't engage anymore because you can't, pass this along to somebody else. Don't worry, I got some more points that'll work with you. Hear what I'm saying? Seriously. It's your body. It's God's temple. This is your body. This is God's temple. What other way does the gospel get spread if it's not through us? And we have to take care of these bodies. We have to take care of this temple. Okay, let me help you this way. Gotta break it down to some folks. I'm gonna break it down to them, Mom. New car. Folks tend to take care of their new cars. You want your new car to last. You know, if it's a new car, you like that new car smell. You know, wish it could last for a long time, but after a period of time, the new car smell goes away. But at the end of the day, you take a new car, many of you take your new car, you get your car washed on the outside because you want it to look good, you want it to be clean. You go get it vacuumed out on the inside, you may have it junky during the week, but at some point when it gets too junky, you go and you clean it out because you want your car to last. Your car represents who you are. So if your car is junky on the inside, more than likely your life is junky. Your body is the same way. When you don't honor your body and you just give your body away to whomever and whenever, wherever, God is not pleased. God says living to please him is controlling yourself and controlling your body. Take care of your body. God desires that you do this because this is where God resides, and stop allowing your flesh to run your life. Look at your neighbor and say, ouch. Yeah, ouch. Now for somebody in here that's like, I didn't come to hear that, it wasn't the Lord wanted you to hear. Don't let your flesh run your life. Because this is what I would leave you with, this question before I move to number two. Is your love for God stronger than your love for sin? Number two, chapter 4, verses 6 through 10. Ready, Erica?
Yeah.
Live to please God by not justifying, J-U-S-T-I-F-Y-I-N-G, your wrongness and how you treat fellow believers. Fellow believers. I'm telling you what the Lord wants you to do. This is how he wants us all to live to please him. Erica, that's chapter 4, verses 6 through 10. This is a sad commentary. Brother Walter Matthews, it's a sad commentary, but I've seen people outside the faith treat each other better than people who are of the household of faith. I have. It's a sad commentary. I've seen gangbangers treat each other better than church folks who treat each other. The unfortunate aspect of this challenge of living to please God is really that the church is full of those who were opportunistic outside the church. And because they never allowed themselves to be converted, they continue to function from this means with those inside the church. But the Lord has offered you a new opportunity to live to do right by treating your fellow Christian the way you desire to be treated. There's no justification in doing wrong to fellow Christians. There's no justification in doing wrong to non-Christians. But since Paul is talking about fellow Christians in the text, in Thessalonica, I'm going to keep the content in the Christian folks' context. So God has given you the gift of a new year. Catch this now. When you crossed over into the new year, God gave you the gift to bury the fury that results in you justifying your unforgiving spirit toward a fellow believer. How in the world can Christian folks say, I love the Lord, and then look at their fellow believer and say, I can't stand them? Say that I. How can Christian folk forgive over 400 years of oppression but can't forgive the person that sit on their pew. How can Christian folk live by the mantra? I'm going to say it this way. Because all of us were saved by John 3:16. God so loved the world, gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believes in him shall not perish, have everlasting life. We're saved because the Lord set it up for us to be forgiven. But yet as Christians, we can't forgive our fellow human being and the person who we are to be in faith with. This is not living to please God when you don't forgive and when you don't bury the hatchet. It's laying down your non-Christ-like behavior and doing what God desires, and that's loving your fellow believer despite how you may feel. And not trying to justify it. You can't justify wrongdoing. The Lord said, there's no justification for it. That's what he said. I'm in the book. And if you're going to live to please God, you cannot justify your wrongness to how you treat somebody in the household of faith. And you can't do it to how you treat somebody else now. Tell your neighbor, wake up. Here's number three. Keep the live to please God up there. Live to please God by practicing being seen as a Christian. As opposed to a Christian always being seen. Let me say that again. Live to please God by practicing being seen as a Christian, as opposed to a Christian always being seen. Now, live to please God by practicing being seen as a Christian, as opposed to a Christian always being seen. All right. Chapter 4, that's verses 11 and 12. Now, I like this right here, Deacon Rizard. Let me tell you why I like this one. The Lord said through Paul's pen that if you're to live to please God, let me remix it. Stop living a reality show life. And for someone that doesn't understand what I mean by living a reality show life is that you see what these people are doing because cameras follow them around. They want people to see how they're living. That's why I don't like reality shows. They want you to see them. They want you to engage in their lives and things of that nature. Paul said, stop living a reality show life. He says, as a matter of fact, if you want to live to please God, here's what you need to do. He said, go sit down somewhere. Mind your own business. Well, here we go. Let's go back. He said, go sit down somewhere. Mind your own business. Now, if you don't believe it, it's in here. It's in the book. You can go to every version, every translation you want to. Yes, the Bible says, mind your own business. He said, go sit down somewhere, mind your own business, and do the work of the Lord. Because if you're minding your own business and doing the work of the Lord, you ain't got time to be minding somebody else. Talk to me, somebody. Huh? Now watch this. And the result of these is so when outsiders look at you, they respect your witness and work as opposed to you always witnessing about your work. Instead of you always telling folks what you're doing, you don't have to tell folks what you do. If you're doing it, they'll see the fruit of your labor. Allow me to take a point of personal privilege being the pastor of West Point Baptist Church. Because although we're not sitting in here with wall-to-wall people, listen, don't get it confused. Folks know about West Point Baptist Church, and they know the work that we have done in these 14 years. So when folks say, oh, you're the pastor of West Point, oh, I know about what y'all have done because our work speaks for us. We don't have to call the media out every time we need somebody. We don't have to call the media out when we say that Black Lives Matter. We don't have to call the media because we want everybody to think we're doing something, because it's not for the media in the first place. It's to affect the lives of the people that God has placed us in this community to serve. And when we stop living this reality show life, we live to please God. So in short, I'd rather see a servant than be the one any day of the week. I'd rather see one than him. Here's number four. Number four. Live to please God. This one right here gonna hurt you. Okay, y'all ready? Y'all still with me? I'm almost done. Live to please God by leading. L-E-A-D-I-N-G, by leading. Okay, here we go, Quincy. Okay, here we go. By leading in loving your pastor. And those he trusts to serve you. Live to please God by leading in loving your pastor and those he trusts to serve you. That's chapter 5, verses 12 and 13. So when I read it, because I got the, Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. All right, so y'all got it? Okay. Now, I do realize that somebody already shut down and surmised that I'm using this as a selfish moment. And if that's you, don't get mad at me. The Lord said, I'm telling you what he said. Live to please God by leading and loving your pastor and those he trusts to serve you. It pleases God when you lead in loving God's servant. Now, don't miss this. Because they work diligently, tirelessly, and steadfastly to let you know what's on God's mind. And I don't want you to mistake what Paul is saying in his text. Don't take the text out of context. Holding them in highest regard is respecting their work while loving them, not hating on them, while loving them, not making their job harder because you feel you can do a better job, while loving them, not using every opportunity you can to let them know how much you hate them. But when you don't lead with love, catch this, it may hurt your pastor or the servant's feelings, but it upsets God. It's in the book. It upsets God. And because God is faith, he tells you up front what upsets him. And whether you like it or not, God gets upset when believers take it upon themselves to make the pastor the target of their anger. To make the pastor the target of their hate and their vile commentary. I'm going to just tell you, it don't just happen at West Point, it happens everywhere. When you're sick and you badmouth your pastor, it doesn't hurt the pastor. It makes God angry. You got to lead in love. And so that God doesn't get upset without you knowing it, he says through Paul's pen that it's important you live to please God by leading in loving your pastor as well as those he entrusts to serve you. It doesn't say bow in humble submission to your pastor. It didn't say believe that your pastor is perfect. it simply says, love, lead in loving. It didn't say treat your pastor like your pastor is God. God was perfectly clear when he says that living to please him is leading and loving your pastor as well as those your pastor trusts to serve you. Again, I got to make sure that you understand what the leading and loving, leading in love means. It means to respect the work they do. Y'all with me? And don't make their jobs difficult by virtue of you just wanting to be difficult. Whew, maybe you never. That number one and number four was a little shaky. Me and the Lord had to talk about those for a minute. I was like, I don't know. All right. Here's number five. Live to please God by working tirelessly to be a disciple of Jesus Christ.
All right.
Live to please God by working tirelessly, T-I-R-E-L-E-S-S-L-Y, to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. That's in chapter 5, verses 13b through 15. Here's the translation. Live to treat others the way Jesus treats you. It's God's desire that each of you serve as an intentional disciple of Jesus Christ, and all aspects of being a disciple requires you to remember how Jesus treats you. And once you remember how Jesus treats you, the gift of the new year will move you into treating others the same way for the purpose of showing them the face of Jesus. That's what we're to do. We can show folks the face of Jesus. Look at what we're called to do. And it's in the text. We're called to live in peace with each other. Live in peace with each other. We're called to warn those who are idle and disruptive. Rather, here's the translation. Warn those who are lazy and like to keep a mess that God ain't pleased with. I'm in the book. We're called to encourage those who are disheartened, rather discouraged. We're called to help the weak. Paul even wrote, we that are strong are to bear the infirmity of those that are weak. We are called to be patient with everyone, because everyone doesn't get it, and everybody don't get there at the same time. So we have to be patient with everyone. That's the very reason why we don't have auditions for the choir. There's some folks that it may take them a little bit longer to learn their parts than others, and you can't get frustrated because you can get your part right away. No, everybody deserves some patience. Talk to me, somebody. Yeah, even the person on your road deserves some patience. That's why I love my seasoned saints, and I try to tell these young preachers that go up in these churches with these seasoned saints, and they want to run over them and bulldoze over them. No, you got to hold their hand. Life is moving fast. Hold their hand. Be patient with them, because if you're patient with them, they'll learn you something. You missed what I just said, didn't you? They'll learn you something. You got to be patient. Babies, you got to be patient. Everybody deserves to be treated with patience. He also says, make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strives to do what is good for each other and everybody else. This is a translation. Work to make sure you don't practice revenge. But if you do, here's how you practice revenge. You show revenge by showing the person a more excellent, godly way. I'm going to tell y'all a secret, and then I'm going to move to these last two. Because you came and because you're watching, here's how you get back at folks. Like when they've been evil to you and they've tried to create and make your life live in hell, here's what you do to get back at them. This is the best revenge. Pray for them. That's it. The Bible says, pray for those that despitefully use you. And you ain't P-R-E-Y-ing for them. You're praying for them. And you ain't praying no bad prayers either. Pray for them. That's how we exact revenge on folks. Because we want the Lord to have mercy on them. And that they would open up their hearts and mind to know and to come to know a more excellent way in God. And make doing good for fellow believers and everyone else a daily practice in your life. This is what living to please God looks like. Number six, live to please God by not allowing anything in 2015 to steal your joy. Live to please God by not allowing anything in 2015 to steal your joy. Chapter 5, verses 16 through 18. Now this is, this is going to be a hidden and quick. There should be nothing that happens in 2015 that has the power to shake the foundation of your faith. Here's something I want to give you for sitting and listening to God. If you want to make the devil angry, ready? You want to make the devil angry? Just laugh in his face by rejoicing. Even when others see no reason to rejoice, keep praying. Although it seems like your prayers aren't being answered, but when you're praying, you're sending the devil a sign that your trust and your hope and your faith still rest in God. That's why, don't let nothing steal your joy. You think of the worst thing that could possibly happen to you, and you just keep on rejoicing anyhow. You just keep on praying anyhow. And then if you really want to give the devil a fit, give me a little bit more on this mic if you don't mind. If you really want to give the devil a fit, give thanks to God in all circumstances. Every circumstance you go through, you give thanks to God because he's trying to teach you something. And here's the last point for you to live to please God while not wasting the gift of a new year. Here's number seven. Live to please God by allowing his spirit to work in you, on you, and for you. To work in you, on you, and for you. That's chapter 5, verses 19 through 23. Don't miss this. Let me read 19 through 23. Do not quench the spirit. I'm going to stop there. The Holy Spirit does powerful work when he's in operation. Holy Spirit does. He's always around. And since he's always around, he's always working. Now watch this. You don't have the power to stop him from working. No, let me say it this way. I'm sorry. You do have the power to stop him from working. All right. He's always around. When he's around, he's working. But you have the power to stop the Holy Spirit from working. How so, preacher? When you suppress him, when you sit on him, when you overpower him by executing your will over the will of God by way of the Holy Spirit will not do what he was sent to do because you don't want him to do it. And God sends his Holy Spirit to aid you, to comfort you, to keep you and lead you. So when you quench the Spirit of God, you are shutting down what God, by way of his Spirit, is getting ready to let loose in your life. That's why Paul said, do not quench the Spirit. It's for this very reason that I want to start the new year by asking you to not fan or stop folks from shouting in the Spirit of God. Don't fan them. Don't stop them. Because when you fan them, you're putting out the fire of the Holy Spirit. When you grab it, and I got it in the old church, that's what we do. Folks start shouting, we start fanning, and we bring them some water. But I'm letting you know, stop doing that. In the new year, the Holy Spirit has gotten a hold of them. And you don't want to quench the Holy Spirit. And when you grab them, not just kind of shift to make sure they they'll hurt themselves, but when you grab them, you are endangering them as well as yourself. Catch this, because the Spirit of God has caused them to be released from something, and when you grab hold of them, you're keeping whatever that's in them from coming out of them, and you're quenching the Spirit of God. Some folks don't shout because they hurt. Some folks shout because they got a release. There's some things God is getting up out of them by way of the Holy Spirit, because he works on the inside of you, and God doesn't send his Spirit to be quenched. But when you allow the Spirit of God to move, he works on your inside. He works on your outer appearance. And he's doing something for you. Well, what is he doing when he's working on you? He's building your endurance. He's keeping you encouraged. He's setting you up to be a survivor. So don't quench him. And definitely not when it comes to the Word of God. You got to test what's being said. Don't get mad about God's Word. I know some of you out there not just as angry as you want to be. But it's all right. Huh? We have to preach in season, out of season, when you want to hear, when you don't want to hear. As long as I'm between Genesis and Revelation, it is up for you to preach whatever's in there. And what the Lord needs you to hear for 2015 is how he wants you to live to please him. And if you don't believe the word going forth, go to God for yourself. That's what he says, you know, test it. Go to God for yourself. Test God for yourself. And when you do, God will reveal what's right. Come on, praise the Lord, come on. And you can rid yourself of what's wrong. And when you live to please God in 2015, God will, not by or through someone else, God himself will sanctify you in every aspect of your life. He will set you apart. But you've got work to do. You've got work to do. Sanctification is when he set you apart, when he had his son die for you, but you've got work to do. Don't check out. This is not just something to just pass the time away and say, oh, you know, he preached for about an hour. No. Put these into practice. Every single day. Don't let the Lord catch you saying, I'll do 2, 3, and 4, but I ain't doing 5 and 6. And I'll think about doing number 1, but I ain't doing number 7. No. Living to please God is putting all of them into practice. So don't waste the gift of a new year. Rest on your feet all over the worship center, those that are here. Rest on your feet. Rest on your feet. Those of the church are now open. I want you all to sing that for me. Those of the church are open. If there's anyone under the sound of my voice who wants to give your life over to Jesus the Christ, or you want to make this your family of faith, we invite you to come back. Now is your time to come. You may come as a candidate for baptism, but let all this experience in the balcony or on the main level, wherever you are, now is your time to come. Now is your time to come. Now is your time to come. he's given to us. Come on and put those hands together. Let's bless the Lord. If you have your gifts ready, hold your gifts up towards heaven. This is First Fruit Sunday. We're giving God what's right, not what's left. We're giving him our best gifts. Is that right? Is that right? All right, all right. Hold them up towards heaven. Lord, we thank you for this time that you've allowed for us to give, not begrudgingly or necessity, but because you love a cheerful giver, and cheerfully we give to you, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, ushers. Those of you that give by way of square, you can move now. Move now. See Ms. Russell now. These are the only persons that need to be moving. These are the only persons that need to be moving. These are the only persons that need to be moving. Persons that give by way of your debit card, you can move now.
My will.
Thank you.
I call your name. Could you just come up here real quick, please? If I call your name, just come up here real quickly. The Witherspoons, are they still out of time? Witherspoon. Sister Iman, come on up here. Deacon Brock and Brown, I'll tell you what this is once you get here. Come on. I'll just back up a little bit. No, come on. Mm-hmm. These, what I'm calling you for is that the children who received gifts that you all heard about Robert to give, they wrote handwritten letters and put their picture, them in their gifts. Now, some of you may not have, you may have given a gift and you may not have a letter or whatever the case may be, but don't just know that they appreciate it, okay? Deacon Brock. This is Mr. and Mrs. Harris. Who was that, Pastor Allen? Mr. and Mrs. Harris? Was that Simone and Jantez? May have been, I don't know. They gave, I don't know, just say it's Harris. Sister Sharon Thigpen. John and Jessica Walker. Oh, wait a minute, this is yours too, Sister Thick Dan. You got a couple of them here. There you go. Wallace, I think that's the Wallaces. I saw his wife, yeah, they said Walker, but I think it's John and Jessica Wallace. Jonathan and Jessica, Pastor Jonathan and his little wife. Wait a minute, come on this way. Come this way. There you go. Monica Harris. Oh, that's Monica and BJ. All right, Monica and BJ Harris. So they're up there working. He's up there working. I don't see him up there no more. Okay. Deacon Felton Mitchell. Come on, Deacon. Dear Miss Flo and Miss Annie. All right. Come on, Miss Flo and Miss Annie. Annie's in the back. Come on, Miss Flo. To the Harris, Dr. Judith Adams, all right, I don't see Sister Adams, okay, Mr. and Mrs. Wallace again, all right, come up here, all right, Ms. Thorne, Ms. Annie, Ms. Neal, and Ms. Kelly, so that's Alexis and Ms. Tawana. Miss Morris, that must be Miss Venus. Come on up here, Miss Venus. Know that we're praying for you. She's going tomorrow to have surgery. We're going to be praying for you. You're going to be all right. Mm-hmm. You're going to be all right. Somebody says she's going to be all right. All right. All right. This one just says, Dear West Point. All right for West Point. And all right for West Point. Oh, this is from DeMarion and Deontay. Those are the twins. Miss Roy and Miss Annie again. Mr. and Mrs. McGee. That must be McGee's back here. Come on up here. I have to tell you about the one from the twins, DeMarion and Devontae, because when I met them, these two young boys, they were doing a whole lot of mouth to the vice principal. So I was standing there because they wanted their phone numbers. I said, and finally I intervened. I said, look, I said, give her your phone number. So the one, he looked at me, he was like, who are you? I said, a grown man, give her your phone number. And I had to get him straight in. I said, whenever you see a grown man, I said, you respect him, you understand? Let me tell you what this young boy said to me. He said, I ain't never had no grown man talk to me like that before. And man, all of a sudden I can't shake him. Crazy about the news. Now this is for Miss Dunbar and Miss Rogers. So this must be for you, Dr. Pierre and Miss Peggy, right? Oh, you have no. Okay. It says, come on, Miss Peggy and Monty. It says Miss Dunbar and Miss Rogers.
Thank you.
All right, thank you all. Thank you, Monty. Dear Mrs. West Point, Miss Griffin, so it's supposed to be Sister Elaine Griffin. I saw her this morning. Mr. Newby, that's Mr. Anna Hill. Oh, here's another one. Dear Dijon Babs, dear Thompson family, all right, Deaconess and Deacon Thompson, our chairman and mayor. Mr. Thompson family, Sister Lynetta March, this is going to be for you, and Miss Lynetta. The Wallace is here, thank you so much. Dear Miss Robinson, this must be for Attorney Natasha Robinson. Must be for you. For me. Mr. Bell. That's you. Mr. and Ms. Wallace. God bless your heart. I want to be on your Christmas list next year. Dear Pastor House. This doesn't have a picture to it, but this is a type of Pastor House. And dear Alex. You think that's the Brother Alex? Come on, Brother Alex. Like I said, others may have given, but these are the letters that we have. Come on, say amen to these angels. And others, angels that may not have received a letter, but thank you all for responding expeditiously to these young people. And I believe the ones that you said West Point were young people who didn't have a name to it necessarily, so I want to make sure that, and again, God bless you. This is what church ought to be. This is sharing Jesus with others. So thank you so much. West Point, let's say amen. There were some of you that gave money. I noticed some of you that given money. Therefore, that things could be purchased, like uniforms and things of that nature. Know that those children did get their uniforms. They did get their uniforms from the gifts that you've been given. All right? One more thing, and then we're going to have community. Mother, come on up here.
Hey,
no, Mother Gloria. Shan, put me in the A flat. Did the post say mother's 85 today? 85 years, y'all. Go right ahead? Okay, well, I'm gonna go right ahead. All right, you ready? Now, which one do you want? You want the jazzy version or you want the slow and easy? Either one. Okay. Brother McKee, you got an A flat? Put me in a C. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Glory, I'm telling you, that glory is sending you in. Yeah, we are. All right. As I always say, keep on living. You'll get your birthday song. Huh? You live to be 85 years old. I'll sing to you too. Huh? You're too young.
See you soon. Let me tell y'all what I share with them at 8 o'clock. This morning, during 8 o'clock morning worship, I told them that there's a scripture that says, y'all going to, there's a scripture that says that the battle is not yours, it belongs to God. And what happens when there is a war, typically you would not claim the victory until after you have won the war. But when King Jehoshaphat heard what the Lord said, which was, you don't have to wait till the battle is over. You can shout now because the victory is already yours. He went in reverse order. He got his praise and worship leaders and his preachers. They went into the battle praising God because God had already said the victory was theirs.
We'll be right back.
taken, he took the bread and he broke it and said, this is my body which shall be broken for the remission of sins. Likewise, he took the cup and he blessed it and said, as often as you do this, you identify with my death and suffering till I come again. We bow down heads and thank our hearts. Let us commune together in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. After they had eaten the bread and drank the cup, the Bible says they sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives. We don't have a Mount of Olives, but we do have a
cottage grove.
And in having a cottage grove, we've got to go out and be intentional on being disciples of Jesus Christ. Making Jesus a priority in our lives, following his teachings, and then sharing Jesus with others. For those of you viewing by way of streaming, we thank you so much for logging in with us. Those of you that will be fasting with your pastor, starting tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. until, I believe it's the 27th, 21-day fast. If you want, you can remain in here, and I will talk to you for a brief moment if you're going to fast. If you're not going to fast, then pray with me. Pray with me every day at 6 a.m., 12 noon, and 6 p.m. 6 a.m., 12 noon, and 6 p.m. Going to engage in the fast and praying. You can be seated and come on and fast with me for 21 days. Amen. Amen. Let us stand on the worship center. Thank you all so much for your patience and hearing what God had to say today. Put his words into practice. And if you happen to mess up, don't give up. If you mess up, don't give up. Start over again. That's the type of God we serve. He loves you. He's crazy about you. And I love you. And I'm crazy about you. God bless you. Go in peace. Visitors, come on up here. Let me shake your hand real quick. If you're fasting, you can just hang tight. Thank you. Praise the Lord.